Well, like anything, it just started off like an idea, like a small thought, and then it just grew from there. It's Ben and Jerry's, what is it, ice cream sundae?
Strawberry cheesecake.
I love dogs. I drive fast. Cinnamon Toast Crunch. If you would have told me that my life would be so different 3 or 4 years later, I probably wouldn't have believed you. And though being a photographer is a really big part of my life, it doesn't define me. My favorite color is blue. Sometimes I sing in public. I think it's yellow. Is it blue? I don't know. Everyone is defined by their experiences in life, and I think this helps shape the perspective of their world. I'm a wife. I am a sister, and I am a daughter. I blog, and people share their lives with me, and I love it. So often I speak freely about my childhood or things that I've experienced. I share it with everybody, because I really want people to know that I'm not defined by who I am now. I'm a small component of a million different pieces. I laugh and I cry. I definitely laugh more than I cry. I'm quiet and I'm loud. I'm loud because for so long I was way too quiet. If I've learned one thing, it's to take who I am and embrace it. All of it, and celebrate it. I've failed a lot more than I've ever succeeded. I think that that's the way life works. You fail a lot more, and the more you fail, the more you'll succeed. So here's to many more failures. I bring that, like who I am, to everything I do, if it's photography or any other aspect of my life. I love, I live. I try to live every moment out loud. I am a photographer, I'm a blogger, and I'm an artist. We all have something that nobody else has, something that makes us truly unique. And it's us. It's who we are. And whether you believe it or not, it's interesting, it's unique, and it's beautiful. I am Jasmine Starr. Hello, OC Photo Summit. Whew. I am so thankful to be here. It's an honor to be here at Saddleback. It's an honor to be speaking to you. For those of you who don't know, I am a wedding photographer, I am a blogger, and I am an entrepreneur. I live with my husband and my very spoiled dog here in Orange County, so it is so nice to be speaking so close to home, because this is my home. This is where I started my business almost 9 years ago, and I'm really happy to be sitting around my friends, my neighbors, and my peers. I first want to start this presentation by showing where the emergency exits are. You'll see them along the side, and you'll see them in the back of the class. I do that for practical reasons, should anything happen, but I also do that for one main reason. At the emergency exits is where I would like all of us to leave our ego, right? Because sometimes we come to these conferences, sometimes we come to summits, and there's a little bit of, so, did you know I got first place at the Orange County Fair photo entries? Did you know that I was featured on this website? I have medals, trophies, and blue ribbons for my equestrian photography. There's a little bit of that in every creative community. So here in this room, I would love for us just to sit around and look at our peers. We're just a bunch of people who are passionate about doing what we absolutely love. Can I get an amen? Okay, good. Okay. Oh, that was so sweet. Okay. You can tell you're at you can tell you're at church. Pastor Rick Warren and I say amen. Everyone says amen, which is lovely. But let me tell you, my daddy's a pastor, and he's not a pastor of a church. He's a pastor of a church. Okay. So he's in East LA. So I grew up in the church, and my dad would give messages or sermons, and he would ask a question, and people would just talk right back to him. Like, it's just the two of them sitting there at church. So all that's what I got used to. So if ever I ask you to give me an amen, I would, amen. Wow. Whew, blasphemy. Amen. I would love to hear back from you because that would make me feel a little bit safer. It would make me feel like I'm at home. And if you are really excited about what I happen to be saying, you could say amen, or you could bring it up a notch by say preach, or you can go to the higher echelon of holiness and say Mount Zion. Okay. I just want us to be okay here. Because more than anything, I want to have conversations. I am not a professional speaker. I am a photographer. So if you guys can see my arms, look at my long arm hairs. They're like on edge right now. I am very nervous. So if you guys talk to me, it feels less like a presentation and more like a conversation. So can I get an amen? Thank you. Thank you. More than anything, you might hear me talk during the presentation about an acronym my friends and I used ever since high school, and it's three easy letters. If you happen to be writing notes, can you just scribble it down? Because if it's the one thing you walk away from today, I will be very happy. Those three letters, K-I-R, keep it real. What this means to me, and I hope what this means to you at the end of the presentation, is that you are being real with yourself. Because a lot of times we get into this because we're so passionate and we don't have enough chutzpah to actually admit, I don't really know what I'm doing. So how about we just K-I-R? Because today I'm going to be very real with you to give you the permission to be very real with yourself and to be real with others. When I was asked to speak here at OC Photo Summit, the team had suggested, maybe asked a little bit, if I would be able to talk about marketing, selling, and building a personal brand. So they know you, and some of them in the group of people that are all connected, they might know your story. But they wonder, and I wonder, if other people know your story, your awesome, amazing, beautiful story. And what makes your story, all of those things, awesome, amazing, and beautiful, is that it's unique. Nobody else has your story. So my question to you today is, what are you doing to tell your story? When people ask me what it means for me to stand on this stage here at OC Photo Summit, I tell people that it forces people to tell their story. Because if you look around this room, I'm going to say that too many of us do the same thing. You shoot with the same cameras. If you're cool, you shoot with Canon. Hey, okay. All the Nikon people, like, get out. Okay, so we might all shoot with similar cameras, if not the same camera. We might use the same lenses. We might use the same Photoshop actions. We might process our photos in Lightroom with the same presets. We might be using the same or similar blog templates or website templates. Are you following where I'm going with this? Because there's too many of us that do the same thing. So how then do you stand out from the crowd? You must leverage the only thing that you possess that is unique to you, and that is you. Sometimes this thing, us, our voice, our story, is the thing we hide behind because it delegitimizes, I'm just making words up as we go along. It doesn't make us feel legit, basically, right? Because we don't want to let people know I'm struggling. We don't want to let people know I'm still shooting in aperture priority because I'm not confident enough to shoot in manual. Can I get an amen? Everyone's like, no, I don't know what she's talking about. I did. I shot my first weddings in aperture priority, and then I just said a sweet prayer. I said, Lord, bless these images. I need it. Okay, I am not even kidding. So as we go along, I'm going to tell you a little bit more about marketing and branding, but I want to share a little bit of my story so you guys understand the background of why I feel so staunchly, so I'm an ardent believer of this. As we go through the presentation, if you guys would like to share via social media using the OC Photo Summit hashtag, Twitter, Instagram, or Facebook, I have a few giveaways that we're going to be kind of monitoring. I'm a huge proponent of social media. We're getting into that in a little bit. But if you want to talk to me via social media, let's get the party started, and you might be winning a couple cool things as we go along. So, a basic introduction, and I really don't want this presentation to be about me. I want it to be about you. But in order for you to see where I'm coming from, in order for you to say, I trust her or I don't trust her, let's talk a little bit about the backstory. I was at UCLA Law School in 2005. I earned an academic scholarship. I didn't have to pay to go to school, and I had worked really hard to be there. I felt my entire life was destined to get to that moment. I'm a first-generation Hispanic, first-generation college graduate, and then a first-generation postgraduate student. It wasn't me just wanting to pursue a degree in law. It was the whole community, my whole little barrio. She's going to college. Yeah, it was a big deal for us. I should probably let you know that my daddy's church is in East LA, so like born and bred, like brown pride, you know? So it was a big deal. I didn't have the wherewithal to admit that I was really sad there. I was really frustrated. I felt like I wasn't supposed to be there, which was so disillusioning because my whole life was building up to that moment. Unfortunately, but now I say fortunately, at the time in 2005, my story was unfortunately, my mother had a relapse with brain cancer. It rocked our family and it hit us to the core. And those two things, me being unhappy in law school and then my mother having a relapse with her 6-year cancer battle, made me depressed. I will stand up on this stage and say it was the worst time of my life, bottom of the barrel. I literally walked into school with my books ready to go to school, and I walked into the dean's office and I said, I need a break. My mom is dying. And they said, you have 5 years to come back and get your scholarships, to come back to school. Go and be with her. I said, okay. I called my boyfriend at the time. We'd been dating 8 years, 8.5 years. And I said, I left law school. And he says, great, do you want to get dinner? And I was like, no, I left law school. And he says, okay, no problem. We're going to make this work. But the problem was that my scholarships predicated me living on beautiful student campus housing at UCLA, and I had to move out within a week because I was no longer a student. He brought his truck down, we dumped all of my apartment into his truck, and he drove me back where? The only place that would have perpetual open doors, and it wasn't Motel 6 where they leave the light on, it was my father's front porch. There I was, 25 years old, and I was like, I'm moving home? I woke up the next morning. That evening, I saw my mom. I was like, I'm making the best decision. I'm going to be with her. I woke up early the next morning, and I stared at the NSYNC poster on my wall that I had since high school. And I was like, I just made the biggest mistake of my life. It turned a corner a few weeks later when my boyfriend proposed. He says, I want your mother at our wedding. So we planned a destination wedding in 4 months. The doctors weren't sure if she was going to be able to go with us, much less be even able to walk me down the aisle. And against all odds, on September 28th, 2005, my mother walked me down the aisle. Whereas other people say, the doctors said it was what they call an instantaneous resolution, and in my family, we just called it a plain miracle. I will say that her life forced me to reevaluate everything that I was doing because she was 50 years old and the doctors had said she wasn't going to make it, and I was 25, and I thought to myself, I'm having a midlife crisis right now because if I die when I'm 50, I don't want to die a lawyer. This was exactly what I was going through. So I'm sitting, you know, it's funny because sometimes people laugh at that, but I was like, no, I'm really being serious. So what happens then is we are having dinner, and I get a letter from UCLA and says, it's time for you to declare that you're going back. And I'm sitting there, this is about a month being married, and I'm sitting at our dinner table, and I'm just crying into my plate of penne pasta. And my husband says, what's wrong? And I said, I'm so unhappy there. And he says, if you could do one thing for the rest of your life, what would it be? And I said, I think I want to be a wedding photographer. What? You don't even own a camera. And I said, I know, but if I did, I really think I would be a good one. And anybody else would hear somebody say that, and they would be like, you're crazy, go back, stay on the safe track, get that corner office in downtown LA, and then we're gonna work for the rest of our lives. And instead, my husband, in his sheer gravity of his belief in me, says, I would rather see you fail at something you love than succeed at something you hate. Go. One, preach, that is right. 1 year, let's give it 1 year. If you fail in that first year, let's go. Go back to law school, get your scholarships, we have nothing to lose. December 2005, Christmas, my husband gives me a camera. He gifted me with a Canon 20D. It's what they call like a prosumer camera. Just a little bit nicer than a consumer camera, but not as nice as a professional camera. And that was okay. I didn't open that camera until January 1st, 2006, because I was like, all about new beginnings. I'm gonna start 2006, so different than how I started 2005. So I opened that camera and I realized I have no idea what I'm doing. And against all odds, I get to meet other photographers by going to workshops, conferences, summits, very similar to this. I meet people and they invite me to second shoot weddings with them. This summer, the first summer that I have my camera, I shot somewhere in the ballpark of 35 to 40 weddings with other photographers. In October of 2006, I booked my first wedding. That month, I booked two other weddings. So in 2006, I book a total of 3 weddings. And in 2007, I book 38 weddings as the lead photographer on my own. And I did that all without spending a dime. Mount Zion. Mount Zion, that's right. See, here's the thing. I talk about big things, and he says, preach. I talk about money, Mount Zion, right? I mean, there we go. Next thing you know, we're gonna get a little tambourine. That's right, okay. That's the story. That's the back end. So you guys know, I'm coming from law school. I ain't got anything. I ain't got money, I ain't got education. We're gonna get into that in a little bit, and yet somehow something happens. Let's talk about the something. Today I'm gonna be talking about how to create a personal brand. Now, I start my presentations with a disclaimer, and the disclaimer is I'm not the bomb. I don't think I'm a guru. I don't think I'm a savant when it comes to branding and marketing. I just want to talk about my experience. I want everybody to come from a place of why. Why should you listen to me? What of value am I going to give you? And if at the end of the presentation you say, I disagree with everything she said, great. I personally believe it's just as valuable for you to say, I like what she says, I agree, or I don't like what she says, I disagree. Because if you know what you don't want, it actually pushes you closer to what you do know. If you know what you don't like, it is equally as valuable for you to pushes you to know what you do like. You disagree with everything I say? Awesome. Do it like Frank Sinatra, do it your own way. A little bit of background on how I started branding. I'm going to admit, I didn't know which way was up. I earned an undergraduate degree in business from Whittier College, and so if you were to ask me how a Fortune 500 company like Starbucks, Target, Nike, how they were branding and marketing their businesses, I could say, I get it, I know how to do that. But to learn how to brand and market me, a single entrepreneur trying to get started in Orange County, nope, no idea. I started a blog in 2006. Are we following the pattern? I start my business in 2006, I start my blog in 2006, and I turn to my husband and I say, I'm writing this blog because I'm going to fail. And I never want to live my life saying, looking back and wondering, I wonder what would have happened. So what I'm going to do is I'm gonna say for this next year, I'm going to blog and I'm gonna write about all my failures. I'm gonna write about how I didn't make it so that when I go to law school and I'm really unhappy, I can bring that blog up and say, you tried and it didn't happen. In February of 2006, I wrote a blog post, and I would like to read that blog post today. Why am I such a chicken? I swear, I should just lay an egg to complete this metamorphosis. I mean, the chicken and I both share entities like feet, breast, and pointed breathing orifices, so if I sprouted feathers tonight, I wouldn't be surprised. I need to be willing to go out on a limb and ask people if I could take their pictures. I mean, I know couples who are engaged, so why can't I bring myself to ask them if I could snap their engagement photos? For crying out loud, I wouldn't even charge them. So what's stopping me? My fear of rejection, of incompetence, of embarrassment. I need to do this. I just need to. That's a person who had no belief in herself. I'm embarrassed to admit that that person put that out on the internet. And yet, in the same time, I'm proud of that person for putting it out on the internet. It fundamentally changed how I approached my business and how I approached my brand. So before we get into the discussion of creating a personal brand, we must first understand the definition of a brand so that we're all on the same page. So what is a brand? Seth Godin, one of my favorite business writers, authors, thinkers, defines a brand as the following. A brand is a set of expectations, memories, stories, and relationships that, taken together, account for a consumer's decision to choose one service over another. So what Seth is saying is that if you're driving to work in the morning and you see a coffee bean and tea leaf on the left corner and you see a Starbucks on the right corner, you're going to make a decision based not, I like that brand better. No, you're going to make a decision based on, I really like the baristas there. They have my favorite drink. The line is shorter. We're thinking about all of these things, and which I'm going to condense his entire definition, bring it back down. We make decisions based on experience. Okay, so if a brand is an experience, what people think about you when you hand them your business card, that's what we're going to be focusing on for the remainder of this. So I want to take a few seconds to talk about what a brand is not. These are things that a brand is not. A brand is not a logo. A brand is not a website. It is not your business cards. It is not your Facebook page or paper goods. Now, a website helps your brand. Your business cards help your brand, but they are not the brand in it and of themselves. So, we've established that a brand is an experience. And this is great news, because if some of you guys are here today and you guys knew you guys were coming to the OC Photo Summit, you guys went to Kinko's, spent $9.99, printed off a bulk of business cards that you put together in Photoshop Elements a week before you came, I feel you. I did the same thing. Okay, I was like, I need business cards. I'm starting a business. Kinko's it is. And when somebody would ask me for a business card, I would be like, it's a work in progress. Okay, I'm here to tell you that the great news is if you don't have the best website and if you don't have the best business cards, but you're really dedicating on creating a great experience for your clients, you're well on your way to getting there and building the foundation of ultimately what you want. Because you can buy new business cards, you can't buy your brand. So when I first started my business, I felt like it was really important to weigh two things. The things I needed to weigh carefully were my assets and my liabilities. My assets were things that I felt I could use to leverage my new business and my new brand, and liabilities were things that I thought were going to potentially hurt my new business, my brand. So in light of full disclosure, we're gonna talk about my top three liabilities. Remember KIR, y'all? I want you to go home and I would love for you to list your liabilities because you don't know how to service, how to improve those liabilities until you get better, and you're not gonna know how to leverage those assets until you know what they are. So liabilities, firstly, I didn't have any money. I was on scholarship in law school. My husband was with a startup company. And I worked part-time at my daddy's church. We had no money. As in our date nights, we would be spending Friday nights, we'd go through the Taco Bell drive-thru, and then we would light a fire. We lived in this apartment that had, it was like a 1920s like bungalow-style apartment, and it had a fireplace. It was not in the best of neighborhoods at all. But Taco Bell in front of a fireplace, very romantic, let me just tell you. So I didn't have any money, so I couldn't necessarily buy the things I thought I wanted. I didn't have any knowledge. I didn't go to a photo school. I had never gone to a photo conference. Frankly, up until I actually made the declaration, I didn't even have a camera. So I'm just saying, like, let's be real. I have no money, no knowledge, and I didn't have a network. It's not like I knew of a bunch of photographers in my community, at my church, people who I spoke to. I didn't have anybody I can ask questions to. So these are my three liabilities. Now let's talk a little bit about my assets. What things that I thought would help me build my business. Well, I liked to write. And if anybody is sitting here thinking, how does writing play at all with photography? I'm gonna tell you, you're not the only person who thought that. Clearly, I'm stretching here. I'm grabbing at thin straws. I don't have the best technical capacity, but I like to write. Now, somebody asked, how are you gonna use it in your business? And I said, I don't really know, but I'm gonna find a way to leverage it. Well, the writing has fundamentally changed how I approach my business because I turned my writing passion into writing about photography. I started my blog, and that is how people found me to begin. My name is Jasmine Star. People think it's like a stage name, and I'm like, no, my mother was a hippie. My twin sister is Bianca Flower, okay? My younger sister, Alexandria Lavender. Like, I mean, my mom just went on with these names. So I felt like my name I could use in a business capacity, and it was unique. So that was an asset. Lastly, I felt like my personality was an asset. Now, I know that my personality is not for everybody. In fact, there are some people sitting in this room with this body language. Okay, I'm not your cup of tea. I get it. But let me tell you something. That's right. That pregnant pause. That's right. I had things that other photographers didn't have. I had just gotten married. That's my target audience. I like the same TV shows prospective brides watched. I'm the same age as those prospective brides. I'm in tune to what the wedding planning process was like. So while I might not be your cup of tea, good, you probably weren't going to hire me. I might be more along the lines of who my target audience is. Now, if you're an action sports photographer, you don't need to care what I think about you. You need to care about what those agents are looking for, what the booking, what the photographic cinematographer, whatever that is in your life, you need to care about what they think about you. And if that is resonating, that is your asset. So if anybody's paying attention, my liabilities were directly related to my photography business, and my assets directly unrelated to my photography business. I'm going to talk to you about how I leveraged my assets and diminished my liabilities. That's the goal that I would love for us to walk away from today. Because what I realized throughout growing my business in the first 2 or 3 years was that brides choose photographers, not just photographs. And readers choose bloggers, not the blog. People choose designers, not the design. So if we follow this pattern, if in the course of your business growing, you look and you kind of say, I agree with that to a certain extent. I do choose to buy my car from this gentleman at this place. I do choose to go to this barista at this coffee shop because we choose that there's this connection that we build amongst people because we crave community. If we agree with that, what are you doing to superimpose your personality in your business? And if you're saying, I don't, I'm challenging you to change that. Because remember how we first started? Everybody here likely has a camera, and everybody here likely has the same lens, and if you don't, you can borrow them from Canon as you go and shoot your demos later on today. What I'm saying is too many of us do the same thing. The thing that makes you unique is you. So, having set that foundation, now we're gonna talk about the how. I'm gonna break this section, I'm gonna break the presentation into 3 things that you can say, this is my homework for when I go home, or if you'd like to do it in class right now, that'd be fantastic. I would love for you to list 3 words. Now these words are going to be how you're going to measure your business success, and they're going to measure how you approach your brand. I would love for them to focus on you, not your business. So if you are an action sports photography and you want one of your words to be adventurous, and yet you're the kind of person who doesn't like to leave Southern California, don't list that word. Because it's not real, it's not you, and people will see it eventually. Be raw and be genuine. What I want you to do also is that these words are to focus on who you are now, not who you aspire to be. When I first started, I aspired to be professional, proficient, and a leader, but I was none of those things. So that would not make sense for me to write those words down. Now these words are going to help your prospective clients genuinely talk about you, not just what you do. Because sometimes people would say, oh, I'm looking for a photographer. You may or may not. Someone's like, I'm looking for a photographer who's really good with kids. And here is Joe, and you met him here through the PICS ministry at Saddleback, and he says, you know what, Joe's a really good photographer, but he's also the assistant coach to his daughter's t-ball team. I think he would be great for your family photos. Could you just imagine? I'm looking for a photographer, check out Joe. I'm looking for a photographer who's great with kids, Joe, da-da-da-da-da-da-da. That's a very different endorsement. When people feel like they're attached to who you are as a person and not just your business, that endorsement is powerful. And that is how I grew my business, because the brand you put online essentially teaches people how to talk about you. Now, if the only thing you're putting out online is on Facebook, so blessed to shoot this family session, and then you put 65 images on Facebook, doesn't say anything at all about you. It doesn't say anything at all about that family. Can you think about 3 nice things to say about that family? put three sentences. That's half a paragraph. And you could also put, so blessed to shoot them, hashtag. You know, like, we get it, okay. But can you start doing things that impose your personality into what you're doing? I had mentioned that these words become the barometer of success, and we're gonna get into measuring that barometer of success in a second. So people often ask me, how do you come up with your branding words? I feel a little stuck. Now, these are words that are associated with your personal brand, and it would be awesome if you listed three words now, and then you revisited your notes in about a week or two so that you could say, you know what? One of these words work for me and the other two don't. That's fine, but get into the action of listing words so that you can start honing your focus just on that. Now, sometimes people take this advice very literally. I have been on websites where I click on it and then it rolls in like romantic and then rolls in quirky or whatever those things. Now, I kind of subscribe to the school of belief. After I got married to my husband, I would walk around and be like, baby, I'm funny. I'm funny. And he's like, if you have to tell me you're funny, you're probably not funny. And that's what I think as I go to websites, and if you have to tell me that you're romantic and you're not showing me that you're romantic by way of your photography, something's amiss. Keep that back in the keep that lodged in the back of your mind. Now, if you are quirky, edgy, funny, silly, and these are some of your words, how then can you capture quirky, funny, silly images? So often, photographers that I've seen, I've been doing this now for 8.5 years, and photographers will say, oh, well, this is who I am. I like Star Wars, I like vanilla ice cream, and I'm really good at chess. And they're like, I can't put that out because brides aren't gonna like that. No, no, no. The wrong kind of bride is going to like the things that you put out online because they're only gonna know what you tell them. Why not own the fact that you like Star Wars? Why not own the fact that you're really good at chess? Because what's gonna happen as a result is that you're going to attract the Bobby Fischer brides. Boom. The more commonalities that you have with your brides, the better they think your photos are. Honest. The more they like you as a person, the more they become your champions and want to fight for you in the long run. And please forgive me, there are people sitting in the front row and I have noticing, I think it's these allergies, I'm spitting up a storm. So please forgive me. You guys are like getting baptized in this front row. I see it, so please know that I'm aware of it. It's very embarrassing. On that note, my personal branding words are fun, fresh, and editorial. I came up with these words because I wanted clients to start describing my work in that way, and I truly felt that they were genuine. When a client leaves an engagement session or a wedding and they said they had fun, good. That to me, I did a successful shoot when somebody tells me they had fun. Fresh. I shoot a lot in different places around the world, but I'm also very centric to Los Angeles and Orange County. My fresh approach is that if I happen to shoot an engagement session, one of 1,023 that I have shot in San Juan, Capistrano, along those train tracks, okay, yes, I know, that's like the place for us in Orange County. And what happens is I don't want to go there and shoot the same pose along the corrugated metal, the same pose along the dilapidated wooden fence. Are you understanding what I'm saying? So fresh means send me the same place 10 times over and I'm going to show you 10 different poses, 10 different ways. Fresh. Challenge myself and let my clients know it's not a repeat. We're going to do something new for you. Editorial. Editorial is something I aspire for. When a bride says that she felt like a model on her wedding day, awesome. When she gets her wedding photos back and she says it looks like they can belong in a wedding magazine, awesome. Anything that is fashion inspired, anything that's driven by editorial work is where I draw my inspiration from, and then if my brides can use that to describe it, I would be honored. I have never spent money on marketing. I started the presentation by saying that. Now, I have to clarify, if I had money, I would want to spend it on marketing. If somebody had said, Jasmine, take a business loan for $10,000, we never took a line of credit for my business because I didn't believe in my business. So everything we did, if I didn't have a lens, if I didn't have a camera, I rented it. If I had $10,000, I probably would want to take out a magazine ad. I probably would want to go to a bridal show, but I didn't have it. I simply had to take what I had and make it work. By doing so, it made me personalize every aspect of my business. Because so often in our lives, unless you came from a very privileged background, all of us at some point or another looked at somebody else and said, that person has more. But what it does is it forces you. There's only two types of people. You look and say, that person has more, that person is better. Then you have two options. Capitulate, say, I'll never get anywhere. Or you say, I see you. I'm going to match you by two things you can't buy. Me. Are you going to fight? Are you going to fight? Or are you going to flight? I would hope that all of you guys have a little bit of fight in you to say, I'm going to do this my way. Because what happens is when you personalize your website, when you personalize your Facebook statuses, people feel like they know you. And when they feel like they know you, they want to promote you. Your broken bones, your fractured ribs, your hot mess of it all, they say, I see you and I like you in spite of it all. Here in Southern California specifically, I would look at photographers when I first started, and I would say to JD, my husband, I said, they have the appearance of limitless everything. The appearance of limitless everything. They had nicer cameras. They had studios. They had fancy cars. They had sample albums of their portfolio work. They had flat screens on their wall when I was still rocking like the 70-inch, not screen, just TV, that protruded from the wall, didn't have a remote control. These were the things that I rocked, and they said, they have all of that. And the only thing I have is me. And I use it as a crutch when I'm asking you to use it today, saying, I know it works. Don't use it as a crutch. Use it as a stepping stone. Everything I put out online is highly personalized. I am, yes, the photographer, but I'm me behind the photographer. This is a snapshot of my website. This is my about section. I talk heavily about who I am and what I do. I personalize, personalize, personalize. I personalize my Facebook, I personalize Twitter, I personalize Instagram. I will personalize anything I can get my hands on because it's a thing that defines me. And you should be personalizing because ain't nobody got what you have. I want to do two things when it comes to social media and my online presence in marketing and branding. I want to attract a prospective client, or I want to repel a prospective client. I never want somebody coming to my website thinking, okay, and moving on. I want somebody coming to my website and having a distinct feeling, good or bad, about what they feel. If a bride comes to my website and says, ugh, I could not stand this girl. Perfect. I just avoided a bridezilla. Okay. Now, here's one thing, too. There's this misnomer of being a perfect, having a perfect client. There's no such thing. We all can deal with people differently. Sometimes your idiosyncrasies might match with my idiosyncrasies, and then we just kind of work. Now, what are you doing to put online to attract a client or repel the client? If all you're doing is putting a gallery of photos and then a bio photo, I mean, then your bio is like, I picked up a 35 millimeter when I was 5 years old and I developed film in my grandfather's garage. Love it. No, I know not a thing about you unless you're 5 years old trying to shoot weddings, which you're not. Tell me who you are. If you are a grandmother and you picked up a camera because you were so impassioned by looking at your grandson for the first time saying, I want to give my daughter, my son, a gift of their photos. And then you think to yourself, I want to give this same gift to somebody else. Tell me that. I don't know what you want to do unless you tell me. So put it out for people. Now what happens is when you are able to personalize things, people talk about you in a very different way. Here's the sample of a bride, Jamie. This is marketing and branding in action. I have said it before and I will say it again. Jasmine Star is amazing. Love her so much. She didn't say, I love my wedding photos. She didn't say, I have a great wedding photographer. She used me by name and then she linked to my blog where I had shared her images. Now, caveat, the average person on Facebook has 350 friends. Anytime I can get a client to create a status update about me, what she essentially did is create a commercial that goes to 350 people, linking to my website, linking to my blog, linking to my fan page, whatever she so chooses. This is powerful. Another bride, Karen. I've seriously brides-to-be. If you haven't picked a wedding photographer and want an incredibly talented and super fun one, she's your girl. She linked to my fan page, and then she wrote about me. And if you guys noticed, one of the words that she said was, anybody? Fun. Exactly. That's my barometer of success. If you are quirky or you are romantic, and you have a bride that comes back to you and says, my photos, they just make me feel like every moment was romantic. Pat yourself on the back. You did it, boo. You set a goal and you got there. Now continue to modify it. These are just a couple examples. This morning I woke up to a bride who we shot in Scottsdale, Arizona 2 weeks ago, and she went through and listed all the reasons why she loved working with us. She didn't say a dang thing about her photos, even though I know she has them and she loves them because she used them for her masthead on Facebook. She used them for her profile picture. She's sharing them in albums. But she says, I loved working with Jasmine and JD because they are just as passionate about wedding photography as I am being a system analyst. And I was like, okay. To each their own, to each their own. But she just sent that announcement to 350 people. Amen. That is free marketing. So up until this point, it is great. We're roughly at the halfway point. This is perfect. So the review up until this point is I would love for you to take what you have and make it work. Even if you feel like you don't have anything, I promise you, you're going to be living that Taco Bell by the fireplace experience. Own it, love it, move forward from it. Personalize your brand by showcasing who you are, not what you do. And lastly, use your branding words to measure your success. Now, I started this presentation by asking you to say, I want you to ask why. But when I first started out my business, the thing that I was asked quite often was because I didn't know which way was up, because I was struggling to book clients, because I was struggling to find my workflow and my business structure. People would say, why? Why do you blog every day? Why are you updating Facebook the way that you are? It seems like such a waste of time. And at the time, I couldn't defend it because I was like, I don't know, but I feel like this is what I should be doing because I like to buy in a certain way. I'm a huge fan of Tom's shoes. I don't even like Tom's shoes, but I'll buy them because I like what they're doing. But I know that Tom's does that because Tom's tells me, for you who are not familiar, Tom's is a buy one, get one, a buy one, send one company. You buy a pair of shoes and they send a pair of shoes to a child around the world who doesn't have that. And I'm like, perfect. I love that. What are you doing to tell clients what you're doing? So I was blogging every day, and people are like, who cares about the stories about your dog? Who cares about your personal stories of how you grew up? Who cares about what you ate for dinner? And I'm like, I don't know, but one day, I'm sorry. I'm crying about social media. I am passionate. I have a cough drop. I'm sorry, you guys. I really am like, my eyes are watering. Forgive me. I don't know what happened. I do. Wow. Okay. I'm back. Maybe that was like the universe just telling me to slow down. Woo! Breathe. No, breathing is for wimps. Okay. I'm just kidding. I'm totally kidding. Okay. So if at this point, you're at this point in the presentation, and you think to yourself, well, that works for you. That wouldn't work for me. Fair enough. I'm going to give you 5 reasons. And all of these reasons don't cost you a dime. So how about this? You do them, and if they don't work, you lost nothing. You do them, and they do work, you owe me dinner. Okay. Here we go. Top 5 reason. 5, differentiation. We started this presentation, and if it feels like I'm repeating myself, it's because I am. This is the thing you need to walk away from. Now, we spoke just recently about the people who I referred to as having the appearance of limitless everything, right? And you might not have what other people have, and you might want what other people have. But branding yourself makes you stand out from the beginning online, from the start. Because what happens is that your intangible competition is your assets. If you're following along with the presentation, hopefully you listed your assets and you listed your liabilities. Whatever is in that assets column, please know that you must use that to stand out. And the more you use that to stand out, the faster you're going to grow. Trust me, I've been saying this for years, and people who do apply it, they grow vastly. A dear friend who's sitting in the audience, his name is Charlie. Charlie came to one of my workshops in Orange County. We became friends on Facebook, and Charlie is so good because he actually Instagrams a lot of what he makes and a lot of what he eats. Now, some people would probably be annoyed with it, but I'm fascinated. I am fascinated that he is so passionate about loving his food, and whenever I think of something great, I think of Charlie. That right there, I'm sorry, in regards to food. When I think of something great in general, I think of my husband, okay? Okay, but food-wise, I'm thinking of Charlie. Okay, So those types of things, how do you want to be associated? What if you challenged yourself for 45 days to take a picture in the same spot at sunset? Then people will identify you naturally by way of your iPhone as a person who loves nature, as a person who's dedicated, as a person who says, I want to share a piece of my world with everybody. Do you see the pattern here? What we definitely do know is that the fourth reason we want to brand ourselves online is selective clientele. Now, when I talk about selective clientele, sometimes it rubs people the wrong way because they're like, well, who does she think she is? She's choosing her clients. No, quite the opposite. I don't choose my clients. My clients choose me. By putting as much information on my blog, on my website, on Facebook, I am attracting them or I am repelling them. If you feel like you're consistently getting the wrong kind of client and being like, how are they hiring me? It's not their fault, it's yours. What are you doing to pre-qualify all those clients to come into you to make sure that you're a good fit? We talked about this before. The more you put out there, the more you're gonna do one of two things. You're going to, remember we have conversations, we're gonna, okay, or we're going to, okay. See, you guys answered like we're at Saddleback. Can you guys answer like you're at my daddy's church in East LA? Okay, one, two, three, you're going to, or you're going to, thank you, perfect. Amen, that was good, you ended it. Okay, so this leads us to basically knowing who your client is. I would love as part of an exercise, now, here's the thing, sometimes people come to my presentation, sometimes they hear me teach, and they're like, that's so silly, I'm not gonna do homework. Guess what? If what you're doing right now isn't working, your homework is for free. Why don't you try it? So, depending on where you are, portrait photographer, landscape photographer, equestrian photographer, sports photographer, car photographer, can you just draft what your ideal client is? I want you to talk, if you're a portrait or family photographer, who are you marketing to, the five-year-old or the mom? Okay, I'm sorry, let me ask that again. If you're a portrait photographer, family photographer, are you marketing to the five-year-old or are you marketing to the mom? Great, now that we know that we're marketing to the mom, describe your perfect mom. Is she the director, the leader of the PTA? Does she wake up at 5:30 and go running at 5 o'clock in the morning to go 5 miles, and then she comes home, bathes her three daughters, splits her hair down the middle, braids her hair down the sides, ties them with a red bow? Is she the kind of mom who lays out the outfits the night before? I'm telling you, it seems silly, but the more that you know who your client is, the more you know how to attract them. Okay. Third reason why you should be branding your business online is reach. We're no longer relegated to who's in our backyard. What was happening was that when I first started my business, I thought I was going to be growing my business in Orange County. But because I went immediately online, it changed the demographic greatly. By our second year of business, we were then shooting weddings in Seattle and Arizona, and yes, Tijuana. We went there. It was my very first destiny. Oh my gosh. Excuse me. I'm like, why? My eyes are watering. I'm losing my voice. Excuse me. I shot a wedding yesterday in about 2 hours from here, and it just takes you from it, you know, like you're out in the dust. I'm sorry, you guys. Forgive me. Okay. What was happening is I put my work out. The easiest way to get national recognition. People come to the wedding. She went to school at the University of Arizona. I share her photos. Her girlfriend, who doesn't live in California but saw her friend's photos, says, can you fly to Arizona for my wedding? Perfect. What if you're not a wedding photographer? What if you take family photos of somebody in San Juan Capistrano, her sorority sister, she comes into town for a Christmas vacation to stay at Laguna Beach, who do you think she's gonna call? You. Then she goes home, and she shares with her friends, and her friends say, we can't get a photographer like that in Phoenix. Perfect. I now know of a lot of photographers who are flying to different arenas because people want them. You have a much broader clientele as a result. You're no longer relegated to family photos in Los Angeles, Orange County, and San Diego. You're relegated to anywhere somebody will fly you. Domestic versus international. As a result, the sooner you can get your roots in, say, Orange County or in LA, and then you start shooting in surrounding states. I'm so sorry. You can then get clients who want to fly you for destination weddings. One of my goals, I grew up very poor. I'm totally okay with that. I think it makes my culture, my history, my legacy rich. But what I wanted to do in my dreams was to be paid to travel the world. I can honestly, wholeheartedly say how thankful I am to have clients fly us to Italy, Mexico, Canada, and Mexico, not Tijuana, okay? Like, Mexico, Cabo. We went to, like, legit Mexico later. What I'm saying is your dreams and your business can be intertwined the harder you work at them. Amen. Love it. Two, top second reason you should be branding yourself online. Archival marketing. So what happens is when I first started, what I wanted to do is I wanted to advertise in wedding magazines. I wanted to advertise online. But when we look through magazines, we flip, and then we throw away, most of us. That's not the type of marketing I want. When you market online in your own forum, in your own way, it becomes archived. A few examples. I'm a huge proponent of blogging. So after a wedding, after an engagement shoot, I will put up a blog post and I'll list the venue. Like, let's say they got married at the Ritz-Carlton Laguna Niguel. I'll put in the title Ritz-Carlton Laguna Niguel Wedding. I write about the couple, and that blog post serves forever online as long as my blog is open. This is how I book a lot of weddings. When a bride a year or two later will go to Google and she types in Ritz-Carlton Laguna Niguel Wedding Photography, my blog comes up really high towards the top. She clicks on it and then she realizes she shot there before. I like her style, I like who she is, I see her point of view, we're booking. Free marketing. I create a slideshow after every engagement session and after every wedding. I bought a slideshow software for, I think, if I remember correctly, $125, but it's a one-time fee. And I host the serving of the slideshows. The slideshows are on my server. And what I do after an engagement session is I'll put like 35 of my favorite photos, I put together a slideshow, I put my logo at the end, and then I send it to my clients. And with a quick note, I loved being there with you guys. Thank you for the honor of being able to document your love. I can't wait for your wedding in June. They get that slideshow and they send it to all of their friends and family. What are they essentially doing? Yes, they're sharing their photos, but they're sharing a Jasmine Star commercial starring them. You can create a similar slideshow, your own photography studio commercial starring your clients. They send it out to you, and what they're essentially saying is, we want to market for you. Amen, Mount Zion. Comments. Comments exist in so many different places, and especially with the changing dynamic of Twitter, they first and foremost exist on your blog. They secondly, first and foremost, exist on Facebook, and now they're somewhat sort of transitioning over to Twitter. Now, what comments do, if nothing else, they act as a reassuring nature for your client. So if I were to post pictures of Sally and Tom's wedding, and Sally's friend from third grade says, Sally, I wasn't at your wedding, but you look so beautiful. Her mom says, I remember this moment, I cried. And people are just saying nice things about the photos. That client is thinking, I made a good decision. It's validating. Anytime a client feels validated with their decision, they are more likely to promote you at a later point in time. Lastly, oh, my favorite, how I love sweet Facebook. Sweet Facebook is so good to me on so many levels. If you're a photographer and you are not selling business to business, you're not like a commercial photographer or a sports photographer in the mainstream effect. If you're a portrait photographer, family photographer, wedding photographer, doing business to consumer direct, Facebook is your jam. I would love for you to friend your clients. And some people are like, no, I can't. Yes, you can. It just means that you have to be a little bit more careful about what you're posting on your personal page, and that's okay. We have a higher business echelon. If you want two personal accounts, one for just your friends and family and one for clients so that you could start building that up, go ahead and do that. But what happens is that they will validate you on Facebook on their blog post. And if you're not friends with the bridesmaid in that wedding, if you're not friends with the cousin of the mom you photographed and she writes, I love these photos, it will show up on that cousin's or that bridesmaid's feed. And now you're marketing to three circles removed to you on Facebook. That is money. Not money in the bling, bling, bling. Money as in freedom. Money as in you get to do what you want and you're being paid for your services. That's what I'm talking about. And on that note, the last and most important reason to be blogging your online, to be sharing your online presence is that it's free. Everything I had mentioned now is free. That's amazing. I bought the slideshow software years ago, and I have made over hundreds of slideshows. Over. So I'm probably now paying 64 cents per slideshow. I can do that. And yes, I'm a nerd. I think about all my costs broken down. So we think about traditional forms of advertising. In the business-to-consumer world, magazine advertisements, we spoke about that. It's a flip, 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 throw. Hardly a few people are actually ripping a page out and stuffing it in their purse like they did back in the day. Bridal shows, in my realm, I don't do bridal shows because what I'm doing is I'm creating a big funnel for brides who just want a wedding photographer. I don't want that. I want a bride who wants Jasmine Starr as her wedding photographer. And the bigger your funnel, the more opportunity you have to attract a bridezilla. No joke. You pay so much money at a bridal show that you need to book at least two or three weddings to recoup that cost. If you're not getting that from a bridal show, I'd be cautioning you to do that. Online ads, when I first started, I was reached out to a company. It says, we have a really popular wedding forum. For a 3x3 cubic square on the side, you'd pay $300 a month to get listed. But I was going to be listed with like 15 other photographers. How do I stand out? I don't. It'd just be my logo, and my logo as a standalone, because we spoke about that. My logo isn't my brand, I'm my brand. So if I'm asked to advertise and I can't showcase who I am, I don't want to do that. Cache that back in the back of your mind. So what are the results? The results is that you can focus on your clients. You're not worried about marketing. You're not worried because that happens by itself. You're not worried about branding because what happens is if you're providing a good experience, it's happening by itself. So I want you to reveal who you are. This can be difficult because we are afraid of criticism. We're afraid of showcasing our weaknesses. We don't want to do that. But I have to tell you, if you're going to do anything great in this world, you will be criticized. You will be ridiculed. But that cost is a small price to pay for you doing what you ultimately want to do. I maintain I would rather be disliked for 100% of who I am than to be liked as a carbon copy of who people think I should be. So three tips on how to showcase your personality. So I'm gonna walk you through the presentation. We spoke about how to choose your branding words. We talked about how to build your online presence. Lastly, as we close this presentation, we're gonna be talking about how to showcase your personality. So, quickly, just because you talk about yourself, it doesn't mean that you're showcasing your personality. Just because you said, I ate cereal for breakfast today, it reveals nothing about you. Three tips. How about you create a bi-weekly series on your blog or on Facebook? So every other week, you talk about something in a pattern so that people then come to expect it. I have developed on my blog something called kisses and disses. I usually write kisses and disses posts twice a month, once every other week, and I write a funny or quirky story about my life, personalizing it. Then I talk about three things I like, kisses, and three things I dislike, disses. So now people have kind of come to expect that this is what's going to happen on my blog, and it's created a lot of good organic conversations. Once I wrote a blog post, a kiss and diss post, about how I don't like to drink milk with my cookies. I like to drink orange juice with my cookies. Okay, so what did I just do right now? I think I really repelled a lot of you. I don't care. So I write this blog post, and guess what? Your reaction was so indicative of what was happening in the comment box. You would think that these photographers were sponsored by like the National Dairy Association. People were offering to send me milk, and I'm like, what? That's fine. Incorporating these ways is exactly what I want you to do. Share knowledge. This is another key component. You might feel, I've only been doing this for a year. Who's going to want to learn anything from me? And I might say, I'm doing this almost 9 years. If there's a person just starting out, who do you think is more relevant in that person's life? You having started a year ago or me having started 9 years ago? Sure, I might have more to talk about. I might have more experience, but that might not be what that person wants or needs at that moment. Own it. I was often ridiculed in the beginning when I was sharing information. And years later, now we have over 500 blog posts dedicated just to photography, and I own every single one of them, the good, the bad, and the really ugly. When all else fails, talk about food. I mean, come on. We've all done that. We connect with others. I remember going to somebody's blog once, and the first post on his blog was he wrote a little ode to his love affair with Reese's Pieces. And I read it, and I was like, I like you more. I didn't know him from Adam, and I said, I like you more. Why? I like Reese's Pieces, too. Birds of a feather flock together, I automatically liked him. So when I'm connecting with readers, and when I'm attracting clients, I know that I'm working on my path to success. But this leads me to ask you, what does success look like for you? This is the last part of the presentation. We get tied up looking to others, and then we measure our success. Well, that person's getting 4 sessions a week, and I haven't gotten one this month. We build totem poles, and we put ourselves, oh, well, that person is better than I am, but I'm definitely better than him. I have to ask you why. Why do we do that? We must be the only person who measures our barometer of success, because it's a barometer of success that you create for yourself. I want you to know what success looks like for you. Please, in your notes, if you're a wedding photographer, can you just write in your notes what your goal is? If your goal is to shoot 4 weddings this year, can you write that and not forget it? Because at the end of the year, if you shot 4 weddings and you felt like a failure, remember this moment in May when you said, if I get to 4, I'm a success. Remember that. Know it. Tattoo it on your heart. Success for me, I don't care what anybody else is doing. Success for me is being able to work full-time with my husband. I get to work at home in my PJs every single day. And I'm telling you, when I don't have to get dressed, I'm a success. The Mount Zion, right. I know. I am not one of those girls who likes to get dressed up. For me, success, if I get to go and pick up my mom for lunch, who still is with us to this day because of that miracle, I'm a success. I get to travel from Tijuana to Cabo to Canada. I'm a success. I cannot care what other people are doing. I cannot care what people criticize me and say, you're not successful. Guess what? I define my success, and I am. I hope the same for you. Write it down in your notes. Take it home with you. Because when you get to that point in your career where you say, I am a success, I want to raise a glass. And since we're at church, it's going to be a glass of non-alcoholic beverage. And say, congratulations, you did it. One of my favorite quotes is by Henry Ford. If everyone is moving forward together, then success takes care of itself. Being here at OC Photo Summit, we're doing this together. It makes our industry move forward, and I'm so honored to be part of this free event because I believe that people here are going to make a fundamental difference in the photography industry. I want to say thank you from the bottom of my heart. If you would like to connect with me, yes, this is my dog. This is Polo. I blog about Polo at least every other week. I dress him up in crazy clothes. I own that. And guess what I'm doing? I am attracting or I'm repelling. If you don't like this photo, that's fine. You ain't gonna hire me. On that note, it is 12:15. I wanted a little bit more time for Q&A, but the mics are gonna be coming down the aisle. I want to make sure that we're tying up loose ends. If you have questions, please raise your hand. And also, JD is going to be bringing me. So this is, oh my gosh, this is my better half. I totally married up. My family has already told me Okay, my family's already told me that God forbid, should anything happen to us, they choose him. I'm not even lying. So I'm gonna give away a few things. This is Exposed Magazine. It's 136 pages about my story. I go into detail about how we started, how we grew our business, how we booked our first weddings, the mistakes, the heartbreaks, and the peaks and valleys. So the first winner is at Lizzie Q Squiggle. Oh, thank you, boo. I have some hauls if you need some. She tweeted at me. She has a cough drop. Follow up with me after. I'd love to give you Exposed. Okay, Duffy Finnegan, your dreams and your business can be intertwined the harder you work at them. She capitalizes. Truth. Thank you, Duffy. This amazing lab, I love White House Custom Color. They're going to give Duffy a metal print, a 20 by 30 metal print. You can use it for personal use, but I prefer you use it for business so you can showcase how good your photos look on a metal print. CHB Stephanie, I'm loving time with Jasmine Starr. Kate, keep it real. I heard a gasp. Is that you?
No, she's volunteering.
Oh, she's volunteering. Too bad. She lost. No, just kidding. I'm just kidding. Have her follow up with me, please. Ramona Chin, can I get an amen? Thank you, Boo. Oh, and she put a photo on it. That's great. I love it. Ramona, you're going to get a wood box from White House Custom Color. You'll be praying. Oh, hi. Great. Oh, great. Two people sitting next to each other? Oh, that looks like we planned it. The Last Magazine is going to Brandon Norton. Love the premise of Tell Your Story from Jasmine Starr, OC Photo Summit, What Makes You Unique. Brandon, you can pick a magazine. If the mics have come down, I would love to take a few questions. Great. I'm sorry? Oh, thank you. Are there any questions? We have about maybe 10 minutes. I wish my mom was in the audience. She would totally ask me a question. Okay, there's a question. Hi.
Hi. I just was wondering, do you shoot in RAW or all JPEGs or what?
I shoot in RAW. Let me tell you a quick 30-second story. I shot in JPEG because it was the only thing I could afford for the first year and a half of my business. The bad thing, I had no latitude to make mistakes or else I lost that picture. The upswing, it made me learn exposure real fast. There was once I had looked at a photographer, he had taken a snapshot of his desk. And he said something on his computer. And then what I did is I got the photo and I took it in to Photoshop and I expanded the photo because I saw that he had CF cards on his desk and I counted them. He had like 16 CF cards and I had 2. I was so hurt, I was grieved, I was jealous. But I said, you know what, I'm gonna take my JPEG and I'm gonna learn. Since then, since I can afford now shooting RAW, I will shoot RAW because on a wedding day, those pictures are valuable and should I make an exposure mistake, I want to know that I can bring it back. Thank you. Another question? Yes. Or who has the mic? Forgive me.
When you do a photo shoot, how long does it take you to give them their product back?
Great. I'm a huge proponent of exceeding expectations. How do you exceed expectations? You first manage expectations. I tell my wedding clients that they will see their wedding images 3 to 4 weeks after their wedding, but I deliver them in 2. After an engagement session, I tell them that they're gonna see their engagement photos in 3 weeks, and I deliver them in 1.5 weeks. Next question. Oh, over there on that side.
How did you go from not knowing anything about photography and not owning a camera to going and being a second shooter at weddings and then shooting your own?
Fantastic. I slept with my manual at night. I'm not even kidding. I'm not so much of a technical learner. So JD would read it to me, and he's a little bit more technical, and then he would break it down in like really layman's terms. I was homeschooled. I own it. I'm very creative. So he would break it down for me, and I say that I went to the University of Google. Anytime I had a question, I would Google it and look up things on YouTube on how to teach myself how to do it. Best teachers. I got involved with online photo forums, which are not so existent these days, but the Facebook photo groups. If y'all are here, create a Facebook photo group with 10 other people, and in that safe zone, you can ask really dumb questions. It was actually there that I met 2 of the photographers who I second shot with the most in this small little photo forum. So Google, ask questions, even if they're stupid, and connect with other photographers. I think that, right here, yes.
What slideshow program do you use?
Wonderful question. Hold on. Sound Slides, SOUND Slides.com. I think it's $125 still to this day. Yes.
When you first started out, did you make mistakes?
Oh, girl. I made so many mistakes. I made so many mistakes, embarrassing. I write a lot about those mistakes in this magazine. I go into detail about those mistakes. Let me tell you one mistake. We fly to San Francisco, and this happened just like 2 years ago. It wasn't even year one. She has an arch, a beautiful arch, but it's only like this high. It's actually an old vintage mantle. She had taken the mantle, she had decorated it, she had put glassware, hung things beautiful from it, and the bride and groom were gonna stand in front of it. Well, before the ceremony starts, my back is to the arch, and I'm shooting chairs and details, and I take a step back, and I'm shooting, I take another step back, mantle falls, everything off the mantle. Yeah, I know. I don't know how to pray in tongues, but if I did, I would be like, oh, Lord have mercy. That's a mistake that happened 2 years ago, and I could still say that I'm here today. You know, there's a mistake. I had a card get corrupted. There's nothing worse than having a card get corrupted. And at the time, and I'm still from when I shoot RAW, and I shoot with 4 gigabyte cards because I'm still so panicked about that experience. It was a 2 gigabyte card, and we lost pictures of the groom and his groomsmen. In the grand scheme of things, it's probably not the most vital, but having that conversation with the bride made me feel awful. So I gave her an album. I took a wash on that wedding, but she's still very happy, and I think that's what the goal of it is, make your clients happy even though you might have made a mistake. But there's lots more where that came from. Back there.
Hi. Do you outsource your post-production, and what albums do you use?
I use Leather Craftsman albums, and I do outsource my post-production to photographersedit.com. If you go to jasminestarblog.com and you search Photographers Edit, you'll see multiple posts that I've written about them, and I'll talk to you about how I use them with specificity. There's a question.
What is the earliest age you recommend starting a business?
The earliest age or stage? Age?
Age.
If people will hire you, you start it. Here's the thing. So often we think that we have to get into it at the career age, but I know wedding photographers who are very successful who are shooting at 18 and 19 years old. And people look at them and they just immediately discount them. But once they show their work and they showcase that they're actually professional and can handle themselves, go for it. And if people don't want to hire you because of your age, then they were never your clients to begin with. Have your portfolio speak for itself. We're going this side. There's, yes.
Hi, how do you handle all the wedding guests shooting over your shoulder? And do you see a trend now with less album and just everything delivered on disc?
Okay, the first part of your question happens all the time. The Uncle Bob, right? Uncle Bob with his little point and shoot, everybody look here at me. Okay, I can fight with that and say, no, everybody look here at me, or I can get in front of it. So if I have all family members behind me, and I set up, take up time to shoot this family picture at the wedding day when I have like 2 minutes and 85 people in front of me, I say, everybody, everybody. Now, everybody's in a line, myself and all the other photographers. I step in front of them, I put my hands up so that I will be in their frame, right? I'm gonna get your attention. I turn and look at them, and then I turn and look at my clients. Everybody, please look at Uncle Joe and Grandma Jean, okay? For the next 3 seconds, look at them. I'm not shooting. I haven't counted. Everybody's looking at Grandpa Joe. Everybody, 1, 2, 3. Thank you so much, Grandma Jean. Thank you so much, Uncle Joe. Perfect. Now, everybody is going to look at my camera. Only my camera, only. Everybody's looking here at the count of 3. 1, 2, 3. Thank you guys so much. I'm going to have everybody move over. That's why I lost my voice yesterday. You know? Give them the permission, then move away. People moving away from traditional printed products, absolutely. Absolutely, it's the nature of the game. And we photographers can fight for it, like you need an album, you need an album. I cannot force somebody to need something that they don't even want to begin with. So I service my clients in the way that they request. There's another question with the microphone. I think I should go on this side.
Hi, Jasmine. Big fan. Facebook, YouTube. Awesome. I've learned so much from your posting, thank you.
Thank you.
Question for you. I've been doing this for about a year and a half. I'm a student as well, photographer student. And my biggest challenge, what I see is pricing.
Okay. Girl, you asked me the $50,000 question, and I got like 30 seconds to answer. You tell me what your question is. I'll do my best.
How do you gauge it? Because I find that there's a lot of photographers out there, they're charging low, they're charging high, they're charging all over. How do you gauge that from a business perspective?
Okay, from it's a great question. From a business perspective, I simply employ the rule of supply and demand. That is it. The more people that inquire of my services, the more I can charge in marginal increments of increase. If you think that you deserve $3,000 to shoot a wedding, I might agree with you, you might agree with you, but if no brides are buying your services, you're not worth that much. And that rubs people the wrong way, but that is just the nature of the game we play. That is it. Secondly, I would love for you to establish if you are a service-based photographer, I am providing you with my services, therefore you are compensating me for that, or if you're a product-based photographer. The difference between the two is that I charge quite a bit up front. I'm a service-based photographer. You're paying me for my time. If you would like the digital negatives, perfect. I will furnish you those at a price. Awesome. If I was a product-based photographer, I would lower my service fee, and then I would jack up the prices for prints and albums and canvases. When I got into the business, I did not want to be a saleswoman. I didn't. I don't want to have to sit down and open up a bottle of bubbly and have crackers and cheese and, how many albums do you want to buy for your grandma? How about we pick 72 images together from a gallery of 1,000? Pull my hair out. Are you kidding me? I want to be paid for me to show at your wedding, do the great business, and you could service yourself the way you want. I use an online gallery called Pixie Set. I deliver all of my images via that. It's a high-resolution image gallery. Clients will download the images immediately. They have all of their images on their iPad computer. Then they have an online gallery that they can share with their friends, and they can buy prints through White House Custom Color. I get to set the price of the prints. I get a commission off the prints. The only thing that I'm getting charged for is the actual cost of the print from my lab. So I get an email coming home from our wedding yesterday. Get an email, boom, $150 worth of print orders. I don't have to lift a finger. That's the kind of business that I want to run because I am being paid for as a service-based photographer. I hope that answers your question in a short amount of time. We're going to do just one more. It's 12:28. I need to have the mic. Okay, there we go.
Hi. Okay, so my question for you is, when you discovered when you knew you were unhappy and you wanted to become from the lawyer to the photography side,
yes,
and you had to start a business, have you ever felt that the business took over you?
Yes. This is a great way to end our presentation. In 2008, I was so consumed with my business, I breathed, I ate, I dreamt, I slept, everything my business. To a certain point to where my husband would say, I wish I was your computer because you caress that mouse more than you caress me. Ooh. It's funny, but it's not funny when your spouse is telling you that. But I said, you just don't get it. I'm following my dream, so you gotta give me space. 2008, our dear friends from Grand Rapids, Michigan, she had called me on the phone crying, and she had said, they found a tumor in David's brain. It's inoperable, and he has a death sentence. And she was crying. She was at the Mayo Clinic. They had flown him from Grand Rapids to the Mayo Clinic because it was that serious. And she cried, and she cried, and she resented herself as a photographer. She resented her business. She had said, for the years that I had spent with the computer, I should have been in bed with my husband, eating bad food and watching terrible television. Please, tonight, be with JD. Hug him and kiss him. Whew. Hung up the phone with her, prayed with her, hung up the phone with her. I sat in my stairwell, and I cried, and I cried, and I cried. And I looked at my husband at the end of the stairs, and I said, I am sorry. I'm sorry that I turned my business upside down to facilitate my ego. Because at the end of the day, the thing that I have is you. That is it. The business won't cuddle with me at night. And the thing I want on my tombstone isn't great photographer. It's wonderful spouse, friend, and human being. Forgive me. From that day, we have set parameters, parameters, parameters. I stop working every day at 6:30. I work banker's hours. I am up at 6 o'clock every day. I pray, I meditate, I have my thing. 6:30 to 6:30 every single day is when I work. He's okay, my husband is okay with it, and I'm okay with it. So once I ever feel like the business is coming too much, I have given myself, my husband too, the permission to say, it's too much. We have been flying this week. I woke up this morning and I felt like there was sand in my eyes. I couldn't even open them. And he says, today, we're having a social media fast. And I said, after I post a photo from the OC Photo Summit, then we start the fast. But the rest of the day, going out to dinner, have some me time, have some us time. Never forget the idea and the journey of dating your spouse because this is the person who's ultimately going to support you and they're going to become an impediment or they're going to become a support. So if you feel like your business is taking over, turn the pyramid upside down and start cutting away things, putting limitations between you and your clients and saying, I'm not going to edit till 1 o'clock in the morning, even though I have a deadline, the deadline isn't worth it if your spouse is dead. And I know that sounds really sobering, but that was the thing that jerked me awake. I wish I could end on a much happier note.